Bien voilà, la technique est au point et I am happy to introduce the last lecturer of this morning session, Professor Marie-Claude Arnaud from the University of Avignon. And she will come back to the topics we already heard about, but we can still hear much more, this Poincaré last geometric theorem, please.
Thank you, and thank you for the invitation. It's true that there is a link with Barney-Bramham talk, because we speak about the same theorem, but he has a symplectic approach of this theorem, and I will speak of the dynamical aspects of the theorem. Okay. So before giving the statement, let me recall that the article sur un théorème de géométrie was published by Poincaré the year of his death, and at the beginning of the paper he apologizes because he has no complete proof of the theorem, but he published it because firstly he thinks that it is true, and secondly he thinks that it is very important for the possible application in celestial mechanics, and I will speak about this application at the end of the talk. So before stating the theorem, let me recall what is a continuous transformation of an annulus. So an annulus is a planar surface between two concentric circles. And imagine that you draw on a table, an annulus, and you put exactly on this drawn annulus another annulus, a rubber annulus, and you distort your rubber annulus in such a way that the rubber annulus is always in contact with the table at all its points, and it's always exactly above the drawn annulus. So you always have the same general shape, but inside, points are moving. So on the picture, you see what happens to some segments, so during the distortion of the annulus. You can have other distortions, for example, a rigid rotation, so it's not very a distortion because everything winds together. And to each such distortion, you can associate a continuous transformation of the annulus, and in fact, to each point of the annulus, you associate T to each point x, T of x, that is the final position after the distortion of the annulus, the final position of x. Okay, now I will use some coordinates on my annulus, so polar coordinates, a radial coordinate that is r, and theta, a polar coordinate, angular coordinate. And the annulus is described by the equation R is between A and B. And we consider a continuous transformation of the annulus. And there are some conditions that were given by Poincaré for this continuous transformation. And the first condition is what is called the twist condition. So when you do your distortion, in fact, you can notice that the two circles at the boundary of the annulus are preserved. But we ask a little more. We ask that during the whole distortion, the two boundaries of the annulus moves in in opposite direction, and this means that one boundary will move clockwise and the other boundary will move counterclockwise. And the second condition that was given by Poincaré is that the transformation preserves the area or, more generally, as a positive integral invariant. So, for example, you see the yellow domain is mapped on another domain that I hope has the same area but not the same shape. So if the two hypotheses are satisfied, then Poincaré says that there are, in the interior of the annulus, so not at the boundary, two points that are not modified by the transformation, that are fixed. So be careful. It doesn't say that when you do your distortion, the points are fixed. It just says that the initial and final position are the same for two points. But maybe in between, they move. Okay, and you can prove that not necessarily exactly this condition, but some conditions, two conditions are necessary. For example, if you consider a rigid rotation, then this transformation is a continuous transformation, and it preserves the area, but it's not a twist transformation. And in fact, there is no fixed point. And it is easy to build an example of a transformation that is a twist transformation that doesn't preserve the area and so has no fixed point. Okay, so let me comment on one point of the theorem that was a little problem. So Poincaré asserts that because of some degree argument, in fact, you have just to prove that there exists one fixed point, because if you have one fixed point, you automatically have two fixed points. But this is not correct. The argument was that the sum of 2 degrees has to be zero, but if you have one point with, I don't exactly explain now what is this degree, but if you have one point with a degree minus one, if you want that the sum is zero, you have another point with some non-vanishing degree. But in fact, you can have one point with a 0 degree. And so this argument was not correct. And in fact, it's very strange because, the argument is Poincaré of formula. So Poincaré knew this formula. So it's strange, but it was not correct. So Poincaré introduced a third condition, that is, there is no invariant point in the whole annulus. And he said, if I can prove that any transformation that satisfies, firstly, the twist condition, and secondly, it has a positive integral invariant, then it does not satisfy the third condition. So it has one fixed point, then it must have two fixed points. And another way to say that is what is written here. It says, I will prove that any twist transformation that satisfies the first condition, so there is no invariant point, has no positive integral invariant. And so the, his strategy was the following one. So he considered such a twist transformation with no fixed point, and he tries to build a loop that wins once around the inner boundary of the annulus, such that its image doesn't meet the initial loop. And so you see here, C is mapped, for example, on T of C, and the domain between the inner boundary of the annulus and C is mapped onto the domain between the inner boundary of the annulus and T of C. And this is a larger domain. It has a larger area, or a larger positive integral invariant. And it, so there cannot be any positive integral invariant. So it's done if you can find such a curve. Okay, but it didn't succeed to prove the existence of such a curve in every case. So just the year after the death of Poincaré, Birkhoff succeeded in proving more or less the theorem. In fact, he succeeded in proving that there is one fixed point if you assume Poincaré hypothesis. But he used exactly the same argument for the existence of the second fixed point, so this argument was not correct. And at the end of his article, Birkhoff speaks about Poincaré strategy, and what I explain you is that, maybe I will put the condition for, if there is a wing that is mapped, strictly inside or outside itself, so a wing between two invariant curves, then there is no positive integral invariant, but it's not clear that if there is no positive integral invariant, that there must be a wing that is mapped on a subset of a superset of itself. And that's what Birkhoff noticed. And so he said that he didn't know if the strategy of Poincaré could work because Poincaré wanted to prove something that is stronger than just the statement of the theorem. And so that's what he wrote. I do not know whether the modification of Poincaré's theorem, which results with the condition that an integral invariant exists, is replaced by the weaker condition that so that's this condition, there is no ring with R equal to I as inner boundary, which is mapped onto either a proper set, subset or a proper superset of itself. I do not know if this statement is true. Okay, sorry. So 13 years after this first proof that was not completely complete, then Poincaré published another proof and another statement, in fact, entitled "An Extension of Poincaré's Last Geometric Theorem." So maybe I begin to explain why it is an extension. So Poincaré, Birkhoff doesn't assume that you have an invariant annulus. In fact, he assumes that your initial annulus is mapped onto a distorted annulus that is between the inner circle and the curve here. So here you have this annulus, a little annulus. And there are other conditions. I will speak about that just after. And why does he ask a weaker condition? In fact, the motivation is to apply this theorem to what happens close to a fixed point of a map that preserves, for example, the area. And of course, this happens for a lot of dynamical systems. If you look what happens close to a periodic orbit, for example, for the three-body problem. And when you are near a fixed point, you can use polar coordinates. And you have an invariant circle that corresponds to a radial coordinate that is zero. So what you obtain for the fixed point when you use polar coordinates. But you have no other invariant curve. And Poincaré wanted to study, Birkhoff wanted to study what happens close to a fixed point, and particularly what happens close to a elliptic fixed point. And here you can have one invariant curve, but no other invariant curve. Of course, if you live in the 21st century, you know that you have, for example, KAM theorem, and you can find another invariant curve if you have good hypothesis. But this was not the case when Birkhoff was alive. So he needed a statement with only one invariant curve. Okay, and so this annulus, this white annulus, there are some hypotheses of this annulus. For example, each radial half line meets the boundary of the annulus at one point. But I won't be too precise. Okay. So Birkhoff assumes that there is an almost invariant annulus, and he has a twist condition that is very similar to Poincaré twist condition. And he assumes that T has at most one fixed point. So it's different from Poincaré hypothesis. Poincaré assumes that there was no fixed point for the proof, and he assumes that there are zero or one fixed point. And the conclusion seems to be what Poincaré wanted to prove. So there is a ring. So I will comment on what is a ring a little later. There is some ring that has the inner circle as inner boundary, which is mapped onto either a proper subset or a proper superset of itself. So in the proof, so here the proof implies completely Poincaré's theorem. So you have two fixed points. And in the proof, they use a perturbative argument to compute some indices along some arcs, some paths. And the perturbations of the map used is the composition of the initial map with some radial translation. And he introduced an interesting notion of epsilon chain or delta chain. Epsilon chain. And an epsilon chain is just so what you obtain, you take a point, you take its image by T, and you allow a small perturbation, radial perturbation, in the upper direction, and with a size less than epsilon, and then you take the image, the same thing, you allow a small perturbation, and so on. And with these ingredients, he succeeded in proving the theorem. But there is a small problem. In fact, when you read Birkhoff's article, he said, OK, a ring is something that is between two closed curves. And well, the problem is that for me, a closed curve is a loop, something like a circle, a distorted circle. But for Birkhoff, this was not the case. And what he called a closed curve can be something that is a little more complicated. So here, for example, excuse me. Here you have a curve that accumulates on a part of itself. And in Birkhoff's statement, so one boundary of the ring can be something that is not very nice. It's not just what I call a loop, what I call a closed curve. And the final statement was proved by Patricia Carter in 82. And here she really proves that there is, with the same hypothesis, you can find a loop, a closed curve, that it's mapped on another closed curve, and that meets the curve meets its image at most one point. So you can have two cases. So let me recall. You have the twist condition plus at most one fixed point. And you have a curve, a closed curve, that it's mapped on another curve. And there are two cases. Either they meet together at one point, or they don't meet. And where they're in, when there is one fixed point, in fact, there are examples where you cannot avoid this case. You cannot find two curves that is mapped on a different curve. And when there is no fixed point, you can prove that, what Poincaré wanted to prove. Okay, and Poincaré wanted to apply the theorem to prove the existence of periodic orbits with long period in some classical problem, the problem of the three-body problems. And well, maybe we can ask ourselves why do we want to find some periodic orbits? So the first reason, in fact, is that, well, maybe it's the only thing that we can do. Maybe it's the easier thing we can do. But it's not the only reason, because when you catch periodic orbits, you can describe what happens, the behavior close to the periodic orbit. So for example, if these periodic orbits are hyperbolic, you can have what explained Rick Mockel, you can have homoclinic intersection and chaos. And if the periodic orbits are elliptic, this means that the differential is like a rotation, then you can prove the existence of other periodic orbits and something more sometimes. Okay, so Poincaré wanted to study the three-body problem. And in his article, he gives the program to prove the existence of periodic orbits with long periods. But of course, it's short, and there is no, it's not an extended version. And in fact, that's Birkhoff who did the job, the complete job. Okay, so you have three bodies, and you want to study the motion, and of course you know that we don't know how to compute the solution for three bodies. We know to do the job for two bodies. So we use that, and so the assumption is that one of the bodies, of the three bodies, that I will call P, the particle, has a very small mass. And in the equation, has a zero mass. So this particle doesn't influence the two other bodies, but it is influenced by the two big bodies that I call S and G. I call them S and G because of Birkhoff, but I don't know exactly why they are S and G. Yes, but what is a particle? So S and G, they have some well-known motion, and we assume that this motion are along ellipses and even along circles. And we assume that the third body moves in the plane of the two circles of the big bodies. And you assume that P is close to one of the two bodies, the J body. So you have J. So I'm not sure that J is what you think, because J has a very big mass and S is very small in Birkhoff article, yes? Really? So maybe I don't know astronomy very well, but okay. So Birkhoff assumes that the mass of J is very big if you compare it with the mass of S. And so this is not the modeling of the third problem, Sun, Earth, Moon, because the particle, the small body, is close to the very big body. So I don't know exactly what it is modeling. And the true problem of Sun, Earth, Moon was treated by Charles Cornet, but in the 20th century. Okay. So to study the restricted, so when one mass is zero, we call this problem restricted problem. and planar it's between, because it's in a plane. Okay. So to study the problem, we use the rotating coordinate system that is attached to J and S. And so you see that the motion of J and S is very simple in the rotating coordinate system because they don't move, but the motion of P can become more complicated. But there exist two families of simple periodic orbits for P. And you can prove one family of direct orbits and one family of retrograde orbits. And I will call them periodic orbits with small periods. So if you imagine that S has zero mass, this orbit has just circular, circular periodic orbits. But here, S has a mass that is non-zero, that is small, but non-zero, so that's not exactly circular orbits. So now, let us think about the position of the particle. We are in a plane, so to determine the position, we need two coordinates, and we need two coordinates for the velocity. And Wegmoekel spoke about an integral of the motion, so something that is constant along the orbit, and that is called Jacobi integral. And in fact, it's not exactly, maybe you think it's the energy, the usual energy, kinetic energy plus potential energy, is not that exactly. It's something that is different. So we were in a four-dimensional space, and we fix a value for the Jacobi integral, and now we are in a three-dimensional space or manifold. And what can be proved is that each level of the Jacobi integral contains exactly one periodic orbit of each family I described before, one periodic orbit with small period. And so Birkhoff, using this periodic orbit, Birkhoff was able to build one annulus, one surface A that is an annulus, not an annulus like at the beginning, not a planar surface between two circles, but a distorted annulus. So it's a distorted annulus, and the boundary of this annulus is just the union of the two periodic orbits that are in the level of the Jacobi integral. And this annulus is a Poincaré section, so the future orbit of every point of A that is not at the boundary will meet A in the first point that I denoted by T of X. Moreover, you can extend continuously this transformation to the boundary of the annulus. Okay, and well, T is not exactly a twist map like in Poincaré statement, but one iterate of T, so the nth return map, if you iterate your map, you find a twist map. And you can prove that it preserves some integral, positive integral invariant, some area. And so you can prove that there are, for some n, two fixed points for Tn. Okay, so you can find two other periodic orbits. But in fact, I didn't give this modified statement, but if you assume that you have the twist condition and the preservation of the area, you can prove not only that you have two fixed points, but an infinity of periodic orbits with long period. And so, if you apply this result, you find in your restricted three-body problem an infinity an infinite number of periodic orbits with long periods. Okay. Okay. Let me just comment about something. Maybe you think that there is a direct and retrograde orbit of that is the twist condition. It's not the case. The twist condition comes from what happened close to the two periodic orbit and the linear part of the dynamical systems. It's more subtle than that. And well, the articles of Birkhoff are, in fact, very long to read and very technical. Okay, and let me notice that, in fact, you don't find periodic orbits. You find periodic orbits in the rotating coordinate systems. So they are not periodic in the fixed system. Okay, I will stop here.
Thank you very much for your nice talk. We have time for questions or remarks. Yes, Mr. Chancinaire.
Yeah, if you want really to have a mapping, a Poincaré mapping from the annulus, you need add the collisions, because you go from direct Hill motion to retrograde one. And in fact, Poincaré did that in a strange way, because he introduced coordinates which were not regular at collisions. I don't know what Birkhoff does. Poincaré does a regularization. Conley does a Levi-Civita regularization, okay. But I don't know what I don't remember what Birkhoff did.
Birkhoff used the Levi-Civita regularization too. Yes.
Other question? So if it is not the case, we thank not only the last speaker, but also all the speakers of this beautiful morning.